Hi viewers, in Botany Online Classroom, today we are going to discuss about recombinant DNA technology. What is recombinant DNA technology? Recombinant DNA in a living organism was first achieved in 1973. By Herbert Boyer of the University of California at San Francisco and Stanley Cohen at Stanford University, who used E. coli restriction enzymes to insert foreign DNA into plasmids. Recombinant DNA technology refers to the joining together of DNA molecules from two different species that are inserted into a host organism to produce new genetic combinations that are of value to science, medicine, agriculture, and industry. So in recombinant DNA technology, we use the different sources of the genetic material, and these two genetic materials are joined together. As we see here, the gene of interest is cut out with the restriction enzyme. As we see here, this is the gene of interest. The character which is desired is located in a specific DNA fragment that is called as gene. So this DNA segment or the sequence, particular DNA, which is responsible for the specific character, desired character, is extracted by using the restriction enzyme. Here, this desired gene containing DNA fragment is cut with the help of restriction enzyme. And also, the desired gene needs a carrier, so that carrier is also called as vector DNA. Usually we use plasmids from the bacteria as the carriers of the genetic material. So this vector plasmid also cut by the same restriction enzyme. So now the DNA of interest is supposed to be inserted into the vector DNA. So both need to be cut by the same restriction enzyme. So the gene, the desired gene, is inserted into the plasmid and ligated with the ligase enzyme. So here we see, after cutting the both the desired chromosomal DNA and vector plasmid with the same restriction enzyme, they are ligated together with the help of the specific enzymes called as DNA ligases. So now this is the plasmid DNA and this is the desired DNA segment containing the gene of interest. So both are ligated together. Now this molecule is called as recombinant DNA molecule. And this recombinant DNA molecule need to be exported, or this is also called transformed, into the bacteria. So this bacteria now is called as recombinant bacteria. So this is, in brief, the cloning process or recombinant DNA technology. So the first step in the recombinant DNA technology is isolation of desired genetic material. So to isolate the desired DNA in its pure form, That means free from other macromolecules, we need to use specific enzymes. As DNA exists within the nucleus along with other macromolecules such as RNA, polysaccharides, proteins, and lipids, the DNA must be separated and purified, which involves enzymes such as lysozymes, cellulase, chitinase, ribonuclease, proteases, etc. So first we need to isolate the DNA from the cell. So the DNA is not in the pure form and it is mixed up with the RNA, polysaccharides, proteins, etc. So it should be isolated in a pure form. For that purpose, we need to use lysozymes, cellulase, chitinase, ribonuclease, etc. enzymes. So other macromolecules are removable with other enzymes or treatments. Ultimately, the addition of ethanol causes the DNA to precipitate out as fine threads. So this is then pulled out to give purified DNA. So this is the total DNA which is extracted from the cell. And also regarding the restriction enzymes, what are the restriction enzymes? Hamilton Smith was studying how Haemophilus influenzae defend themselves from bacteriophage attack. So Haemophilus influenzae is a bacteria which is resistant to the bacteriophage virus attack. So he was wondering how he was able to, that bacteria was able to defend itself from the virus attack. So he discovered that bacteria has specific enzyme, that enzyme can chop up the viral DNA. It can digest the viral DNA so that it can defend itself from the viral attack. So he then identified that specific enzyme as a restriction enzyme. So this restriction enzymes act as molecular scissors. These scissors can cut the DNA at specific sequences. So these sequences are called as restriction cut sequences. So number of cuts made in DNA will depend on number of times that target sequence occurs. So wherever that restriction site occurs, that restriction enzyme cuts at a specific site. So the site at which the restriction enzyme cuts the DNA is called as restriction site. So how many times that restriction site repeats, then that many times the DNA is cut by the restriction enzyme. So these reactions are called restriction enzyme digestions. So the DNA which need to be cut by the restriction enzyme is incubated with restriction enzyme. Then that restriction enzyme under the favorable conditions cut the DNA at specific sites called as restriction sites. So this process of incubation is called as restriction enzyme digestion. So this process, by this process, DNA, purified DNA is cut with the specific selected restriction enzymes under optimal conditions. Now we see the digestion of the DNA sample. So when we extract the DNA from the source organism, that means when we identify a desired gene in a specific organism or in a specific cell, so we need to extract the total purified DNA from that cell or from that organism. And then that purified total DNA is digested with the help of the restriction enzyme. So now we see, for example, here, this is the source DNA which contains the desired gene. So this colored part is the desired DNA segment which contains the gene of interest. So the remaining DNA is not needed. So it should be cut by the restriction enzyme. So now we see where the restriction site is located. For example, if we want to use the ECO R1 restriction enzyme, now we have to see where these restriction sites are located. So there are several restriction sites here. So here, when we cut the DNA with the help of the restriction enzyme, that means the digestion of the DNA sample, here we see these fragments are generated by the restriction enzyme cutting. And also at the same time, the carrier which carries the desired gene is called as plasmid DNA here. Now this plasmid is extracted from the bacteria, and this plasmid also need to be digested with the same restriction enzyme. So now we see this plasmid, it is digested by the ECO R1 enzyme. It is cut into two parts. So now we see the purified DNA and the vector of interest are cut with the same restriction enzyme, and this gives us the cut fragment of DNA and the cut vector that is now open. Now, so in the beginning, the first step is the cutting the DNA of interest from the source organism. So in the beginning, we have to purify the total DNA from that organism, and the total DNA is incubated with the restriction enzyme. And now we see after digesting the total DNA with the restriction enzyme, now we got the specific DNA fragment of interest. And now we also need the vector DNA. It might be usually plasmid DNA. That plasmid also need to be cut by the same restriction enzyme, so that they both of them have the complementary sticky ends. So third step is ligation of the DNA sample and plasmid DNA. So as we discussed earlier, so this is the DNA of interest. So this is the DNA fragment generated by the restriction enzyme, and this is the plasmid vector which is generated by the restriction enzyme digestion. So both are cut, and now they need to be ligated, the DNA of interest and the vector DNA. So the DNA of interest, it contains the gene of interest. Now both are put together, both are incubated together with the help of the enzyme called as DNA ligase. It acts as the adhesive. So it joins the cut fragments together. Now we see this one is the ECO R1 digested plasmid vector, and this is the ECO R1 digested DNA sample of interest. So both generated sticky ends. So when both are mixed together combined, that process is called incubation with the help of the DNA ligase enzyme and the ATP, then both the cut ends are ligated. So both the cut ends of the vector DNA and cut ends of the chromosomal DNA segment are joined together. It is also called as ligation. So that enzyme which helps the ligation is called as DNA ligase. So it needs energy in the form of ATP. So the next step is transformation of the ligation products, that is called as recombinant DNA. So as we discussed earlier, this plasmid contains the DNA of interest. Now this plasmid is also called as recombinant DNA plasmid. So as it contains a different DNA. So it contains the DNA of the source organism and DNA of the plasmid vector. So this vector now is called as recombinant DNA vector. So this recombinant DNA vector need to be exported or transferred into the bacteria cell. This process is called as transformation. So the ligation product is a recombinant DNA vector. It need to be transferred into the bacteria. This total process is called as transformation. So the process of transferring exogenous DNA into cells is called as transformation. There are basically two general methods for transforming bacteria. The first is a chemical method by utilizing the calcium chloride and heat shock to promote DNA entry into the cells. So to promote the DNA transformation, the first method is called as chemical method by utilizing the calcium chloride. And the second method is called as electroporation. There we need to give the short pulses of electric charge to facilitate the DNA uptake by the bacteria. So these are the two main methods. One is the chemical method, and second one is called electroporation. Now we see the first method, that is the chemical transformation with calcium chloride. Now we see the bacteria, the E. coli bacteria is grown in the liquid medium in the conical flask here. So this flask contains the culture media, liquid media, and which contain several growing bacteria in log phase. So now they are growing very rapidly. That phase is called as log phase. And now these bacteria suspension culture is again centrifuged to isolate the bacteria, and it is this isolated and centrifuged bacteria is resuspended in calcium chloride solution. Now you see this bottle contains the resuspended bacteria in calcium chloride solution in the ice. Now this bacterial culture need to be poured into different append of tubes, and this is stored at 80 degrees centigrade. And now the recombinant plasmid DNA is added to the append of tube, and it need to be given the heat shock immediately so that it promotes the entry of the recombinant plasmid into the bacteria. And now this culture of the bacteria along with the recombinant plasmid DNA is plated onto the LV agar medium, and which contains the ampicillin. Now what we see, the bacteria which got the recombinant plasmids, that means the transformed bacteria only can grow on the medium here in the presence of the ampicillin. Ampicillin is the antibiotic which kills the bacteria without the plasmid. So the plasmid usually contains the ampicillin resistance marker. So with the help of the ampicillin resistant gene, the bacteria which contains the recombinant plasmid can grow in the presence of the ampicillin. But the bacteria which is not transformed by the recombinant plasmid cannot grow in the presence of the ampicillin antibiotic in the liquid on the agar plate, because the bacteria which got the recombinant plasmid has a selective advantage of the resistance to the ampicillin antibiotic. So now we see the bacteria which grow in the form of the colonies. That means all these bacteria which are growing on the medium or the transformed bacteria. Now we see another method of the transformation, that is transformation by electroporation. So now we see the process of electroporation here. Here, this conical flask contains the E. coli bacteria in the liquid culture, and it is centrifuged, and the next that centrifuged bacteria is resuspended in the sterile H2O water. And now that is again after keeping in the ice for some time, it is again centrifuged and resuspended in the sterile H2O. And now that culture which contains the bacteria is poured into the append of tube, and at the same time the plasmid, recombinant plasmid DNA is also included in the same append of tube. So both are mixed, the bacterial cells and the recombinant plasmids are mixed in the culture medium or in the sterile water. Now it should be given the heat shock. That tube which contains the bacteria and the recombinant DNA plasmid are given the heat shock for a short time period, and now that is transferred to the saline buffer and plated onto the agar medium which contains the ampicillin antibiotic. Now we see the bacteria which grow in the presence of the ampicillin antibiotic are the transformed bacteria, because only the transformed bacteria can grow in the presence of the ampicillin antibiotic, as they contain the ampicillin resistant gene in the plasmid DNA. So the bacteria which got the plasmid DNA or the recombinant plasmid only can grow in the presence of the ampicillin. So now we see again the insert self ligation and vector plus insert ligation and vector ligation. So here the insert, the DNA can self ligate, but it did not enter the bacteria. So when we plate that bacteria, when we plate that plasmid onto the ampicillin plus X galactose plate, they can't grow. And when the bacteria which contains the self ligated vectors also can grow in the presence of the ampicillin and the X galactose plate, all of them appear in the pink color, because if there is only plasmid, this is the just plasmid without the gene of interest, that means it is not the recombinant plasmid, it is just the plasmid. This plasmid doesn't contain the insert, that means we see the lacZ gene which produces the blue color. This lacZ gene produces the blue color. So when the DNA of interest is not inserted into the plasmid, when this plasmid enters into the bacteria, those bacteria can survive, can grow in the presence of the X galactose and in the presence of the ampicillin. They appear in the pink color or blue color. They indicate that they contain only the plasmid vector, which doesn't contain the DNA of interest. Now we see this plasmid which contains the insert, that means the DNA of interest is inserted here. Now it is also called a recombinant plasmid. So when this recombinant plasmid enters into the bacteria, here we see that bacteria is not colored. It is not colored because that insert that DNA of interest is inserted into the laxy gene. As the laxy gene is disrupted, broken, it doesn't produce the blue color compound. So they don't appear in blue or pink color. Now we see the some of the colonies are colored and some of the colonies are non-colored. So the non-colored colonies indicate the transformed bacteria. So these non-colored bacteria indicate the presence of the recombinant plasmid vector. So now we have to select the bacterial colonies without color. That means these colonies contain the recombinant plasmid vector. So step 5, blue colonies represent ampicillin resistant bacteria that contain plasmid vector and express a functional alpha fragment from an intact laxy alpha coding sequence. And the white colonies represent ampicillin resistant bacteria that contain the insert and they do not produce the laxy alpha fragment. So they don't appear in blue color. So which are the bacteria we need to select? Which are the colonies we need to select? The white colonies are need to be selected. So now we see the types of cloning vectors. Different types of the cloning vectors are used for different types of cloning experiments. The vector is chosen according to the size and type of DNA to be cloned. So the DNA of interest, depending on the length of the DNA of interest, we need to select the plasmid vector. If the DNA of interest is large size, we need to use different kinds of the vectors. So based on the size of the DNA of interest, we need to select the cloning vector. Now we see the plasmid vector. The most popular cloning vectors are plasmid vectors. So plasmid vectors are 1.2 to 3 kb size and they contain replication origin. So it is also indicated by ORI, that means origin of replication. So each plasmid should contain origin of replication. And as this gene permits its self-replication, so each plasmid need to be self-replicated. So it is also called amplification. So this self-amplification or self-replication needs the presence of the specific gene called as origin of replication indicated by ORI. And next, that plasmid also should contain one antibiotic resistance gene. Usually we use ampicillin resistance gene, chloramphenicol resistance gene, ampicillin resistance gene. So there are several resistance genes which are helpful as a selective advantage. And exogenous DNA can be inserted into the bracketed region. So this region is called as multiple cloning site or MCS. So where there are several restriction sites are located in this region where we can insert the DNA of interest. And also, as we discussed earlier, selective marker is required for maintenance of the plasmid in the cell. So this selective marker or the resistance gene which gives the selective advantage of that bacterium to grow in the presence of that antibiotic. So those bacteria which got these plasmids only can grow in the presence of the antibiotic. So this plasmid which contains the antibiotic resistance gene gives a selective advantage for the survival of the bacteria in the presence of the antibiotic on the medium. So the under the selective conditions only, cells that contain plasmids with selective marker can survive. And genes that confer resistance to various antibiotics are used. and genes that make cells resistant to ampicillin, neomycin, or chloramphenicol are used. So these are called as selective markers. So those genes which gives the selective advantage for the cell are called as selective markers. Usually they are the ampicillin resistant gene, neomycin resistant gene, or chloramphenicol resistance gene. And origin of replication, as we discussed earlier, each plasmid should contain a gene called as origin of replication gene, that is indicated by ORI. So this origin of replication is a DNA segment recognized by the cellular DNA replication enzymes. So without this replication origin, this plasmid DNA cannot be replicated. So there is due to the presence of this origin of replication gene, each plasmid can multiply, can amplify. So this is also called as self-replication. So, and the, as we discussed earlier, multiple cloning sites. So presence of the multiple cloning site is necessary for the plasmid carrier. Now, what we see here, this is the ampicillin resistance gene, this is the origin of replication, and this is the multiple cloning site. This is also called as polylinker DNA. You see here, there are several restriction sites. So there are restriction sites for the BAMH1, HIND3, SOL1, ECOR1, SMA1, SPH1, XBA1, KPN1. So these are all the restriction enzymes. Each restriction enzyme recognizes a specific sequence called as restriction site. So this region contains restriction sites for all these restriction enzymes. So we can use any of these restriction enzymes to cut this plasmid. And multiple cloning site, gene to be cloned can be introduced into the cloning vector at one of the restriction sites present in the polylinker. So as we discussed earlier, you see the diagram here. When we use the ECOR1 restriction enzyme, it cuts the DNA in this region, multiple cloning site. Now we can ligate this cut DNA with the gene of interest here. So this plasmid is cut and it is ligated with the gene of interest. It produces the recombinant plasmid. So now you see the sequence of the polylinker DNA, which contains the restriction sites for several restriction enzymes. So ECOR1, this is the, it represents the, this sequence GAATTC represents the restriction site for the ECOR1. And now this sequence represents the site for the SAC1, and this represents the site for the KPN1. So these sequences represent the restriction sites for the various kinds of the restriction enzymes. Now we are the liberty of using any of the restriction enzyme depending on our convenience. Now you see that genomic DNA, which is extracted from the source organism, is cut with the restriction enzyme, which has the cut ends. And the plasmid vector also is cut by the same restriction enzyme. So they, both of them produces the specific sites called as restriction sites or the sticky ends. So the sticky ends of the both the, this is the sticky end, this is the sticky end. And this is the sticky end, this is the sticky end. Both the genomic DNA and plasmid vector is cut by the same enzyme here, ECOR1, and now they produce the sticky ends, and both of them are pooled together and in the presence of the specific enzyme called as DNA ligase, in the presence of the ATP, and both are ligated to form a vector called as recombinant plasmid vector. So plasmid vectors are used to clone DNA ranging in size from several base pairs to several thousands of the base pairs. That means 100 base pairs to 10 KB. That means 10,000 base pairs. So this is the PUC18 vector. This is the famous vector used for the cloning called as PUC18 vector, as this is produced by the researchers from the University of California. UC stands for University of California. So as this plasmid is produced from the University of California, it is named as PUC18. It contains the origin of replication and ampicillin resistance gene and also LAGZ gene, which contains several restriction sites. So when the gene of interest is inserted into this part, this LAGZ gene becomes non-functional. That means the bacteria which contains this recombinant plasmid won't produce blue color. So now coal-E1 based PUC vehicle is commercially available. Once, for example, PGM3 and P-Blue script are the commercial varieties of the cloning plasmids. And what are the disadvantages of using plasmids? So they cannot accept large fragments. So plasmids can accept up to 100 base pairs to 10,000 base pairs of DNA fragments only. So, and standard methods of transformation are insufficient. So back next to type of the plasmid vector, next type of the cloning vectors are called as bacteriophage lambda. Phase lambda is a bacteriophage or phase that is a bacterial virus that uses equally as host. So this bacteriophage DNA also can be used as the cloning vector. So its structure is that of the typical phase, that means head, tail fibers. Lambda viral genome is 48.5 kilobase and a linear DNA with a 12 base pair single strand DNA, sticky end at both sides. These ends are complementary in sequence and can hybridize to each other. These sites are called as cos sites or cohesive ends. And infection. Lambda tail fibers adsorbs to a cell surface receptor and the tail contracts and the DNA is injected. And the DNA circularizes at the cos site and the lambda begins its life cycle in the E. coli host. Now you see bacteriophage lambda, genome of the bacteriophage lambda is approximately 45,000 base pairs. And the recombinant phase DNA can be packed in the phage particles, and the phage particles are used to transfect the cells. So when the phage particles they infect the bacteria, that genome within the bacteriophage enters into the transfected cell. And this genome, it is self-ligated as it contains the cos sites, and they produce several bacteriophages. So next to cosmid vector, the purpose is to clone large inserts of the DNA, that means size of 45 kb. Features cosmids are the plasmids with the 1 or 2 lambda cos sites. So now this is the hybrid. Cosmid is the hybrid between the plasmid and the bacteriophage DNA. So the plasmid which contains the cos sites is called as cosmid. So presence of the cos site permits in vitro packaging of cosmid DNA into lambda particles. So this cosmid contains the ampicillin resistance gene as it is present in the plasmid DNA, and also it contains the different kinds of the resistance enzyme markers, and also it contains the cos sites, and it contains the multiple cloning sites where we can incorporate the gene of interest. So thus they have the selective advantages of lambda as cloning vehicle and a strong selection for cloning of large inserts and infection process rather than the transformation for entry of chimeric DNA into E. coli host. So these cosmid vector also can be inserted into the E. coli, and this rather than the transformation, what the process occurs here is the infection, and the main they maintain the cosmids as phase particles in solution, but the cosmids are the plasmids, thus do not form plaques, but rather cloning proceeds via E. coli colony formation. So cosmids are the plasmids. So instead of the forming of the plaques, when the bacteriophage infects the bacterial colony, they form the clearing zones called as plaques. So those plaques are not formed here. Thank you.